Today I want to talk to you about the Inca and their amazing system of numbers. The largest civilization in the Americas before the arrival of the Europeans. They peaked about the 16th century, where the area covered by the Inca Empire started in Colombia in the north, went all the way down to sort of bits of Chile via Peru, Ecuador, and Bolivia, all in the Andes. So that's about several thousand miles, but about 12 million people. So the Incas are really interesting because of the, what you call them, Bronze Age civilizations, they were the only one that didn't have certain important things which the other Bronze Age civilizations did. They didn't have a wheel. You can maybe explain that because, you know, it's the Andes. Wheels, is that going to help you get up a mountain? They also didn't have a writing system. But what they did have was this amazing system for recording numbers, and they did this using knots on string. The system is called Quipu or Quipu. Sometimes it's Q-U-I-P-U, sometimes it's K-H-I-P-U. I guess it's a Quechua word. Quechua, which incidentally is the indigenous American language still spoken by the largest number of people. There's about, I think, about 10 million people speakers of Quechua, and that was the language of the Incan Empire. Anyway, I have a Quipu here. This Quipu is a replica of one that is in the American Museum of Natural History in New York. And Quipus are bunches of strings. They've got knots on, but there is some kind of method to them. Often they were colored strings. Obviously this is some kind of colored line, so not this type of string, but they all had a primary cord. So that's the yellow one. So that's the cord that doesn't have any knots on it, but all the other ones hang off it. It's like a massive kind of janitor's keyring. Often there were hundreds of strings. Here I've only got five other strings, and you've got these red ones are the strings with the knots on. And the green one is a certain string that links this set of four. So you see the green one links the set of four, and the green one also has some knots on. And what I would like to do today is to explain to you how this works, but by replicating the original decipherment of Quipu. So it was in the 16th century that the Incas were conquered by the Spanish, and then knowledge amongst Europeans of how Quipu works was completely lost. And it was only rediscovered in 1912 because a maths teacher, a guy called Leslie Leland Locke, it's a fantastically alliterative name, Leslie Leland Locke, maths teacher from Brooklyn, went to his local museum, the American Museum of Natural History, saw this very Quipu, and worked out from the knots what it meant and how it worked. And so why don't we go through what he would have done? The first thing is, let's look at each bit of string. So when you look at the string, you see that it seems to be that there are three positions, and in each different position here, here and here, there are certain knots. So what I'm gonna do, I'm just gonna write it out. I'm gonna say string one, we're gonna have position one, position two, position three. So this is the first one. So in position one, we've got one, position two, we've got three, in position three, we've got four. So, already we get some kind of sense of what this might be, because all the numbers are quite low, actually not going above six, which is kind of interesting. So that might be the first clue that something is going on here. And now let's just put a line here and let's do the green string. So this is the green string. This is the string that links them all together. So string five, I guess. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, actually. So that's eight first. Then there's quite a big gap, so that's zero. One, two, three, four, five, and that's five. So Brady, or maybe anyone watching this, already you've got this. Can you begin to see what the knots might be recording and what the relation might be between these four strings, the four red ones, and the green one that links them together? It's actually very simple, but if you didn't know it, it's almost impossible. Well, it's very, very difficult to try and find out. That's the intellectual efforts required to decipher something, because you're not entirely sure what you're looking for. But I've made it, in fact, incredibly simple, because if you actually look here, let's add these ones up. Four, six, 5 is 15. So 5, carry 1. 3, 6, 5, 5 is 19. With that 1 carry is 20. Put 2 over there. 1, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 8. So Leslie Leonard Locke realised that the answer was staring him at the face. It was nothing more complicated than each string represents a single number, a single three-digit number. So the one that has 1 in position 1, 3 in position 2, and 4 in position 3 is actually 134, because position 1 is the hundreds, position 2 is the tens, and position 3 is the units. The Incas, you know, they had this massive empire, 10, 12 million people. They had bureaucracy. Bureaucracy requires numbers and statistics. So in a sense, the Quipus, which were used for census information, for measurements, for money, essentially was the gel that glued this entire empire together. And what you would have, if you needed to record a number, you'd put this three-digit number, or it could be longer, if you needed more digits, on each string. And if you wanted to add them up, to save adding them up, you would join them with another string, and that would be the sum. So this is incredibly efficient. And in fact, what they'd done is they'd kind of invented the decimal system without realizing it. What they hadn't done, there wasn't a zero knot, so you had to realize there's a space there, so that could be quite confusing. But they knew other things. So actually, here, I've done them all with the same knot. That's because I'm not very good at doing knots. The way that the Incans did is that the last knots were always slightly different. There were slightly longer knots. And that's because a slightly longer knot was always units. So just say you had a piece of string that came detached or something, you could look at it and you think, oh, okay, I know exactly the way this is going to go. I know to read it, this goes units, tens, hundreds, and so on.
This doesn't seem like it would have been the hardest thing to figure out. Like, well, how could this be a mystery for so long?
Well, it was figured out in 1912, so the whole studying these civilizations was not very developed. Also, people were probably interested in other things about that society, and there weren't that many quipus that you could go and have a look at. Some of the quipus had hundreds of strings. If you're going to be kind of pulling them apart, it's quite hard to know where to look. But also, why would you even think that it was arithmetic and numbers? Even to think that, it's much easier once you know that. It could have been anything else. You could have thought, oh, this is something that's going from 1 to the 3 to the 4, it's getting bigger. There are lots of other patterns that you can see.
It could have been jewellery or headwear or something.
Yeah, well, I think people knew that from studying it, and obviously when they were conquered in the 16th century, they didn't all die out. They kept on using it, bits and bobs, and also there were Spanish historians that came over and wrote about it and said, oh, it's well known that they had a sort of counting number system which was based on these strings and knots. But yeah, the proper decipherment was only made in 1912. There are about 1,000 quipus around in museums, and a lot is still not known about them. It could be the case that some of them, the knots, actually represent phonetic elements. So one of the great mysteries that people who look at, Incaologists looking at today, is was the quipu more than just the Inca's counting system, but also some interesting new type of writing system?
This episode was supported by Brilliant and its ever-expanding collection of puzzles, problems, and in-depth courses. Have a look at some of this from their scientific thinking course. No wonder they call it Brilliant. It's interactive, it's clever, it's fun. It's like going to the gym for your brain, but without all those sweaty changing rooms and stuff. By the way, Brilliant doesn't have to be just for you. Why not give Brilliant as a gift to a friend or family member? Young or old, who doesn't love upping their game and boosting their brain? Go to brilliant.org/numberphile for more. There's 20% off Brilliant's premium subscription if you use that URL there on the screen. That gives you access to everything. And our thanks to Brilliant for continuing to support Numberphile. Alex, this was so fascinating. Where could I read about this?
If you want to know more about that, in my new book called The Language Lover's Puzzle Book, I have a whole section on the quipu and on about the decipherment of it. In fact, the book has lots of... You think it's just going to be about language, but it's also about scientific language and mathematical notation. And so you're going to learn about the history of mathematical notation also in this book.
I can't wait.
I can't wait. Christmas. That's a great Christmas present, hey?
Yeah, especially in lockdown.
Yeah.